if you want to kind of frame the discussion with, you know, what we do and don't know as you understand it about how this disease is transmitted to and from children.
Okay. For me, as a pediatric infectious diseases physician, from the very beginning, I was intensely interested to see how this pandemic would affect children, both in terms of their clinical health, but also in terms of public health implications. And early on, we really didn't have much data, but as more and more data come out that address this question, I think it's crucial for the medical community to really be able to, you know, provide clear and consistent interpretation of what the scientific evidence is telling us as it relates to children. So part of the issue is that the data set is a bit more limited. What we do know, however, has been painting a pretty consistent picture, and that is that children appear to be less susceptible to getting infected with this coronavirus. And when they do get infected, they tend to have very mild symptoms. So they're at far lower risk for having severe disease as a result of infection. Furthermore, it does appear that children, particularly younger children, appear to be far less likely to transmit the virus or pass it along to others. Most of this evidence comes from household cluster data. So when infections have been identified in children, contact tracing allows us to try to figure out, where did the infection come from? Did the child get it and then pass it along to the family? Or did an adult in the family get it and then pass it along to the children? And almost without exception, what we see, the pattern that we see is that children are catching this disease from adults in their household. They're not the ones catching it and passing it along to other children or other adults.
Right. So in terms of the body of evidence that we have, it's not very large yet, but it is consistent.
That would be a fair way to describe it. It's not a large body of evidence, but consistent across multiple settings, multiple countries. There are a number of countries in Europe, for example, that have now also reopened schools, and that gives us more of a clue specifically on child-to-child transmission. And by and large, in almost every country in Europe, at least, that has opened schools with strategies to mitigate transmission within the school setting, we've not seen large school-related outbreaks.
What do we know about how children of different ages spread this, right? Like, what are the, I guess, like thresholds, or, and can we even get that granular given what we know?
Yeah, that's a good question. I think that most likely this should be seen as a gradient or a continuum with the younger children, particularly school, you know, elementary school age children, being far less likely to either contract the infection or transmit it. As kids get older and start moving into the teenage years, they do start to approach the adult rates in terms of likelihood of acquiring the infection or potentially passing it along. It would still be important to point out, however, that for older kids, meaning, you know, teenage, as we get into the teenage years and approaching 18, even if their likelihood of catching the infection does appear to increase compared to the younger children, they still show a similar pattern in that they have very, very low rates of severe disease. And so many of them can catch the infection, but generally are either asymptomatic or only have very mild symptoms.
Your commentary in pediatrics, you know, talked about how we should prioritize keeping schools open. We should explore strategies for doing so safely, and the available evidence suggests that, you know, we can do this responsibly even when there is some level of community spread. Is this any level of community spread, low levels of community spread? You know, like, is there a difference between the community spread that we're seeing in Vermont versus Texas in terms of whether or not it would be safe to reopen schools based on what we think we know at this point?
Yeah, that's a great question, and it's a very challenging one to answer because a lot of the ability to maintain safe school environments has not only to do with things that are happening within the school setting, And going along with that is, you know, do the local districts have the resources to, you know, implement these plans and, you know, the means to do that? But it also depends so much on the scenario in the community, not only in terms of rates of transmission, but capacity for local healthcare systems to be able to identify cases, test, contact trace, isolate, et cetera. So there are a number of factors that go into it beyond just sort of rates of transmission. And therefore, it's hard to give, you know, a hard and fast number in terms of how much is too much or, you know, at what point is it safe. Certainly in Vermont, we are not seeing significant levels of sustained community transmission. So I would argue that, you know, Vermont is as well poised as anywhere in the country to, you know, sort of model how we can do this and how we can do this safely.
What do you think of the theory that the reason children are not often the index case is because they've been more cooped up, right? It's their parents who are going to the grocery store. It's their parents who are running errands. It's easier to control the social interactions of children versus adults.
Yeah, that is an important limitation to the data and one that we should acknowledge. You know, when we say that we still have very limited evidence, this is one of the challenges, is because children have been, for the most part, at home and not around other kids to the same extent that they normally would be, it's been challenging to generate the evidence or the studies that see how does this really affect kids when they're around lots of other kids like they would be in the school setting. So that is an important limitation to the data. That's why I think it will be so crucial to continue to monitor the situation going forward as schools do reopen. But again, I do think we have a lot of reassuring data from European countries that have reopened schools that that pattern still appears to be holding up, that when children, particularly younger children, are returning to the school setting, that they still appear to be really less likely to catch the disease or to pass it along to their schoolmates.
What do we still not know, or what do you still have big questions about when it comes to infectiousness and age?
Well, there are a number of questions. One is, you know, probably the most relevant is, are we able to confirm what we have been seeing with more limited evidence up until now, that these patterns will continue to hold true as we reopen schools to a larger degree. So once kids are exposed to a lot more children. So I think that will be a crucial piece of information that we want to keep a close eye on to make sure that these patterns continue to hold true, specifically within the school setting, as more kids go back to school. I think why it is that children are so less likely to be affected by the virus. So either that means why they're so less likely to become infected, and when they do become infected, why they have such a milder course of illness, I think are really important questions to answer. Going along with that, you know, why is it that they appear to be less likely or less able to transmit it efficiently? Whereas the same child who might be infected with influenza, we know can probably do a pretty good job at passing along the flu. These are really big, important questions that hopefully we'll begin to have some increased data on as schools reopen more.
I think those are basically all my questions. Is there anything else you want to say that I didn't ask about?
No, I guess there are a couple of personal pleas, I guess. The school reopening issue has become so intensely political in so short a time. And my own personal plea is, you know, I think that maybe this is just a sign of our times, that there isn't any issue that can escape being politicized, even one as important as the health and welfare of our children. You know, I guess my plea would be, please, let's not make this a political issue. Let's not pick sides based on a pro or anti stance based on political affiliation. We need to all work together to make sure that we can reopen schools safely, regardless of political belief, affiliation, or background. I think we should all be able to come together and agree that making the school safe for our children and their teachers is a priority that's important for all of us. And that relates to another plea that I have, and that's that we really should be viewing schools as essential services. I think that, you know, I'd be surprised if there's anybody out there who would disagree that educating our children is essential for our society. And, you know, especially for the younger children who really appear to be at the lowest risk of getting infected and at the lowest risk of transmitting it, a year of either remote learning or less than full-time in-person education, I fear really could have lifelong consequences, particularly for children on the margins who may have special healthcare needs, who may have emotional or intellectual challenges to begin with. I think we really shouldn't underestimate how profound an impact not providing in-person schooling to these kids really can be.
That's it. Thank you so much. This has been a really fantastic interview.
Oh, great.